imitating him as an example and patron. Like him, may he be completely united to you and enter into the ranks of your chosen ones, whom you have blessed and allowed to share the sufferings of your beloved Son on earth and his glory in heaven. We praise and thank you, your only Son and your Holy Spirit, forever. With the church and your children.
Forever.
Amen.
Let me enter into eternity, listen to your holy scriptures. To you be glory forever.
Incense and ask for your mercy, O Lord.
Peace be with you.
And with your spirit.
From the Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to St. Matthew, who proclaim life to the world, let us listen to the proclamation of life and salvation for our souls.
Great son of the listeners, the Holy Gospel is about to be proclaimed to you. Listen and give glory and thanks to the word of the living God.
The Apostle Matthew writes, "Then dismissing the crowds, Jesus went into the house. His disciples approached him and said, 'Explain to us the parable of the weeds in the field.' He said in reply, 'He who sows good seed is the Son of Man. The field is the world, the good seed the children of the kingdom. The weeds are the children of the evil one, and the enemy who sows them is the devil. The harvest is the end of the age, and the harvesters are angels. Just as weeds are collected and burned up with fire, so shall it be at the end of the age. The Son of Man shall send his angels, and they will collect out of his kingdom all who cause others to sin and all evildoers. They shall throw them into the fiery furnace, where there will be wailing and gnashing of teeth. Then the righteous shall shine like the sun in the kingdom of their Father. Whoever has ears to hear, let him hear. This is the truth. Peace be with you.
Creation.
so that other beings can participate in the goodness which he is infinitely in himself. And between that moment and the revelation of the children of God, those who have responded, as it says in the gospel, the good wheat, who have responded to this divine charity, being revealed, our Lord says in the gospel, shining as the sun within the kingdom of the Father. Between that moment of creation and the moment of that glory of shining of those who have responded to the divine charity, we have this moment of time. This groaning and waiting for the moment of the full revelation, and in between is the time that we live in now. And St. Paul gives us a salacious statement, because what he wants us to understand is when we have perceived, when we have heard that voice of eternal charity, we respond to it because of that grace. Something takes place within us already as an actuality, which is that death and resurrection of our Lord, by faith, by baptism. And so that when he speaks about this in earlier verses, in the first part of this chapter 8, he's not insisting upon the cooperation of grace, because he's not insisting upon our activity. He's insisting upon what God does within us as an actual victory when we have responded. Which is why at the end of this chapter, he goes through this whole list of all these things that exist in creation. Nothing can separate us from the divine love. Not sufferings, not crucifixions. He talks about the height and the depth. He's talking about astrological things. Not the stars, not the planets, not the powers of the air, not angels, not principalities, not dominations. Nothing, not life, not death, can separate us from the love of God. That is the seed in which God transforms and begins to transform so that we may shine on that last day as the children of God, as the sun, shine as light. Today we also commemorate on the 22nd of July, we commemorate also Saint Nora. Saint Nora, his name means light, Nora. So to the Greeks he's known as Saint Lucian. And as a result, he is the great preacher of the gospel in Mesopotamia. But we won't do a sermon on him, otherwise we're all going to be totally melt. It is also the feast of Saint Mary Magdalene, and she is an exemplar of what divine love does in a person's soul when they respond, that reciprocation that's given, love for love. We can be benevolent, we can be beneficent, but if the people to whom we give that love don't respond, it's never what we call friendship. You're just simply a good person. And God is eternally good. God is in itself the divinity, eternal benevolence and beneficence, which is waiting. It is what we call the long-suffering of God. His patience of waiting for each creature, each man, each woman, each child, to respond to what is proposed to them of a transformation. Now, of course, what we're commemorating today is the feast of Saint Charbel, whose feast day is actually tomorrow. But in honor of Dame FIFA, who was insistent that we do it on Sunday, saying that they knew the hymns and everything. Who could resist, especially in the year of her investiture into St. Gregory? But St. Charbel, of course, is an amazing figure. So he's born in 1828, and he dies in 1898. This is not a medieval saint, this is a modern saint. And he chooses the path of asceticism, which in the modern notion of love is confusing. Because how can you renounce everything in the world and go off to the top, literally to the top of the mountain, and claim that you're being motivated by love? You're leaving everyone behind. And yet, as Maronites for us, of course, this is the pinnacle of perfection, to choose the ascetic life. Now, we're not all going to go up to Anaya and live in a hermitage. But it means that as Maronites, our proper spirituality is that as we advance in age and wisdom and in years, that our life becomes more and more detached from this world and more centered upon God. We may be married, we may have grandchildren, great-grandchildren. But the Maronite spirituality is that we move to a life which is focused contemplatively, ascetically even, upon God as the years go on. Which is why God gave us St. Charbel. This is a man who not only lived the ascetic life, which of course within Faith Maron is highly respected and considered the goal in this ascetic and monastic movement, which is our church. But he's given to the modern world as an example for us. You know that in the mid-20th century, the Hermetic ascetics, the Hermits, actually died out in the Maronite Church. 1960s, 1970s. And it's only in the last 20 years that we have men who once again have embraced those caves and the mountains. Much to our relief. Because to be Maronites and not to have hermits is not to be Maronites. And one of these gentlemen who has chosen this life of hermetic life, he is Colombian. And he is also from a Latin background who has embraced the beauty of the Maronite Church. He is one of the three men in Lebanon. Now, as you may know in St. Charbel's life, this divine grasp of ascetic life, which seems so unusual to the modern eyes, is of course following our Lord's teaching in the Gospel, in which he says, "He who loves father, mother, brother, sister more than me is not worthy of me." That's a very harsh saying in the Gospel. And you may know the story of St. Charbel's vocation. But at the age of 18, he left in the middle of the night from his farm. He left. He left home, and he joined the monastery. And the next day, his mother and his stepfather, his father had died. His mother was angry. Now, he didn't tell them ahead of time because he knew they would resist his vocation. And so, what's told in the story is that his mother went to the monastery and she demanded to see him. And he would not come out to see her and only spoke to her through the door to remind her that I have left the world. And his mother, in the absolutely magnificent Mediterranean quality of femininity, went into a fury outside that door that her son was not coming out. And in that magnificent, glorious, as I said, Mediterranean femininity, she shouted at him through the door that if you don't come out, then you had better become a saint. And she left. Which, of course, was his intent from the beginning also. And hearing that story, we see that he is definitely the son of his mother. The same determination, the same ihidoyuto, singularity of vision to pursue God. But of course, we forget that other than the village of Adonai, nobody knew Father Charbel. Finishing, he went through about 20 years, a number of years in the monastic life in community. Then he entered into the hermetic life as an ascetic and as a hermit. So even further into solitude by being a hermit, no one knew. So what God accomplished in St. Charbel's life was actually what God did miraculously in the decades following his death. In that, from 1898, Charbel's body was always incorrupt. So it wasn't just that it didn't decompose. The body was supple as if he was sleeping. And this went on for decades. But what also famously happened was this liquid that continually came off of the corpse, reddish, wasn't blood, it wasn't composed of blood, but this was a reddish liquid that came coming off to the body. And the fathers of the monastery actually found this annoying, because it was rotting everything, the coffin, the habit. They once then had one of the monks who was in charge of trying to take care of this body. And the body was taken through what I consider actually kind of shockingly somewhat disrespectful to think about it, but they're trying to figure out a way to dry out the corpse. It keeps exuding, including taking the body each day to the top of the flat roofs of the monastery, stripping the body down in front of the sun, and trying to dry it out. And this goes on for years. And what God was doing was calling attention to who this hermit was who left the world, and now God has made world famous. Even the Latin Church have put St. Charbel's feast on their calendar. Because what took place over the next 65 years was calling attention to the remains and making the fame through the miracles and the pointing out of the very body itself of St. Charbel. But when St. Charbel was beatified in 1965, the end of the Second Vatican Council, at that point, the body was allowed to decompose. It was kept in this very unusual state until recognition was made of not only these miracles, but the other miracles that were being accomplished and what this man's life had meant. This is why I mentioned to you the paradox that in the 60s and the 70s, the hermetic life actually died out among the Maronites. God made sure that in 1965, He holds the attention of the world, not just Maronites, upon what the ascetic and hermetic life was, and is meant to be. So this is the extraordinary aspect of St. Charbel, and that all of creation waits for the moment of a revelation of something which is taking place, that took place not only in St. Charbel, but is taking place also in us. St. Paul calls it predestination. And on some Wednesday evening at the adult religion class, we'll go into a further explanation of predestination. The only thing you need to remember from the epistle this morning is that eternal and divine charity, which is God, is free and sovereign and can choose to do as God chooses to do. The other aspect of it is each one of us is free to respond to grace and divine charity or not. And then lastly in this great mystery is that no one is predestined to hell. That's classic John Calvin. And that Calvinism is condemned by the church. There is an orientation and predestination to the divine light. We are free, God is free, no one is sent to hell by God. That's all you need to know right now. Later on we'll go to the ins and outs of it. But what it means is that this exemplar that we talked about last week of the incarnate Word being the image in which every man, woman, and child is created in, that incarnate wisdom also died and rose from the dead in glory. And that is the firstborn from the dead that St. Paul also makes reference again in this epistle this week. That image is made of not only the fact that we are human beings created in the image of the Word incarnate, but that we are given by the divine love the possibility of entering into what He freely accomplished by His death on Calvary and that triumph of the glory of the resurrection. We can respond, or we can refuse. When we respond, that transformation of death to life is what takes place within us, as St. Paul gives the actuality at the beginning of this chapter, but it is what grounds the sure reason for our hope of the benevolence of God and God's protection by His providence.
which gave us that quotation in the beginning, that we know that for those who love God, everything that happens in their lives is happening for good. That is a tremendous idea, but it only comes by that reciprocated love to God's charity and grace. So may Saint Charbel intercede for us and obtain for us that determination, the ihidoyo, to be focused upon a singularity vision of following our Lord, so that He can transform us. And I have to give you one detail. So for the last year and a half, I've been trying to republish the book of Core Bishop Ede of Saint Charbel. And I'm leading you down this path of death and resurrection over the whole year in general, but specifically today with Saint Charbel. Because when we've done this book was written originally in the 50s, and then re-edited in the 60s with the beatification. And originally it was just going to be a single private printing. And the people in Fall River, because that's where he was pastor, they were quite exuberant for this. And they voluntarily gave well over $7,000 to reprint this book. We reworked the whole text, we did the whole thing, we did an edition. And in the meantime, Bishop Gregory suggested other places to print the book, so it would have a larger distribution. Good idea. The reason why I'm giving you this detail is not because of the printing of the book. Because the first printer that we took it to, they looked at it and they said, well, this is not really what we would like to publish. And you're thinking, who doesn't like St. Charbel? And what they brought up was to say that we didn't think that the modern readership would appreciate the details in the story. And you're like, well, that's his life. And what do you want us to do with it? Rewrite the life. But what they pointed out was precisely his departure in the middle of the night at the age of 18. That was too harsh, I guess, for the modern readers, but it's completely the gospel. And then, of course, when he was a hermit, his sister would go to Mass on occasion at the hermitage. And he had an oratory in the hermitage, but no woman ever came into the oratory. So she was at the doorway on the outside. And for St. Charbel, it didn't matter if it was his sister. She was also at the door. Those are the only two examples in the story of his life, because that's about the only thing we know about, and the rest is prayer and penance. That was rejected by the first printer. But fortunately, right now, Ignatius Press is also considering making a whole division and a branch of Eastern Catholic books. And it happened, they knocked on our door pretty much exactly the same time when the first publisher said, not really interested. So now it sits at Ignatius, so I asked him to storm heaven through the intercession of St. Charbel, so this moves, because it's been a year and a half now we've worked on this project. Because, as Maronites, we can appreciate that singularity of vision. We can appreciate the fury of situ outside the door of the monastery. May St. Charbel intercede for us to increase that faith, increase that divine love of reciprocation, so that God can accomplish that solidifying hope in resurrection by His grace within each of us. And may the prayers of St. Charbel be a rampart to us always. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen.
Father, glory. Yeah.
Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Oh,
of the Father, you have exalted our imitation through your grace. In your abundant mercy, you sent your beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, into the world. He came down to us by the Holy Spirit, became flesh of the Virgin Mary, accomplishing all things for our salvation. He is
Thank you.
blessed being healed. May those in distress find comfort in those who repent be whole. May the prophets be remembered, the apostles honored, the martyrs crowned. And may the confessors exult and the angels rejoice. May your divinity be praised and your trinity be honored, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, now and always and forever. She is founded upon your hope, remembers your salvation, and awaits your kingdom. We offer to the bishops of the true faith, grant them the wisdom and knowledge that comes from you, and make them worthy to proclaim your kingdom, especially Francis, the Pope of Rome, Charles Peter, our Patriarch of Antioch, Charles Peter, our entire Patriarch, and Gregory John, our Bishop. May all the shepherds of the church be sanctified their days by care, in fear and in justice, for your people that you have entrusted to them. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember, O Lord, the priests and deacons here and everywhere who serve diligently and are vigilant over their flocks. May they receive their reward. Remember those who are taking vows of chastity and holiness to keep their bodies and thoughts pure, that they may triumph in their efforts. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember, O Lord, our civil leaders who love you and all of those you wish to govern us. Strengthen and assist them so that they may live in peace under their leadership. Crown them with true faith and good works. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember, O Lord, the children of the church, redeemed by your passion and given life by your death, for they share in your resurrection, those who are far and those who are near, those who are weak and those who are strong. Remember those who presented these offerings upon your altar, and accept them on your heavenly altar. Hear their just requests in exchange for their earthly gifts. Grant them the gifts of heaven. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember, O Lord, in your grace, those who we have remembered and those who we have not. In your mercy, have compassion on them. Remember especially those in distress, who experience hardships, the poor, the weak, and the grieving, those in exile and captives and prisoners, the oppressed, outcasts and dejected, orphans and widows. Remember those bound by the chains of sin and subjected to various passions. Through your body and blood, may their sins be forgiven, their faults be pardoned, their weaknesses be cured, and their wounds be healed. We pray to you, Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember, O Lord, in your great mercy, our fathers and patriarchs, the teachers of your holy church, who were pleasing to you from the beginning. By the glorious light of their teaching, they brought back people from darkness and ignorance to the true light of the holy gospel, and they fought to preserve the integrity of the true faith. Through their holy prayers, grant peace to your churches, monasteries, and convents, and put an end to war and all strife throughout the world. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember, O Lord, your holy church that you established on a solid rock of true faith, and send your vocations to the holy priesthood and religious life. In a world of distractions, which pulls away from properly loving you and our neighbor, may those whom you have called to serve your holy church respond to you and have the courage to follow your will. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember, O Lord, all your saints, especially ever-Virgin Mother of God, the prophets, apostles, martyrs, confessors, and all who profess the Trinity in their true faith. Through their holy prayers and petitions, look upon us with eyes of compassion, and may your calming and pleasant face shine upon us. Make us worthy to share their reward in their inheritance, and may their shadow be a shelter and protection for us on the fearful day of judgment. We pray to you, Lord,
have mercy.
O Lord, in the sweetness of your compassion, receive the souls of our brothers and sisters, the children of baptism, and upon to you the true faith from this world of darkness, especially those who are the sacrifices of God. May this be your body and blood be a pledge of life for them, a fire that consumes sins in a burning coal and destroys all transgressions. Mercy, grant the best and blessings of light and joy in the heavenly Jerusalem. O Lord, of all people, grant us life, divine blessings and mercy, and forgive our sins and theirs.
Grant us, O Lord, to God, and forgive the sins we have committed with our lawful knowledge.
O Lord, do not deprive us of your mercy, but keep us in the palm of your hand, lest we fall away.
Power and glory. lead us, your lowly children, into temptation, but deliver us from all evil. The kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours now and forever.
Amen.
Peace be with you.
And with your spirit.
Bow your heads before God of mercy, before his forgiving altar, and before the body and blood of our Savior, who gives life to those who partake of it, and receive the blessing of the Lord.
O Lord, we have approached your holy altar, the source of divine gifts. May we share in your holy mysteries and join the assembly of those who glorify you, that we may raise glory to you now and forever.
Amen.
The grace of the Most Holy Trinity, eternal and consubstantial, be with you, my brothers and sisters, forever.
Let each one of us look to God with reverence and humility, and ask him for mercy and compassion.
Holy gifts for the holy, with perfection, purity, and sanctity.
One holy Father, one holy Son, one holy Spirit, blessed be the name of the Lord, for he is one in heaven and on earth. To him be glory forever. Make us worthy, O Lord God, so that our bodies may be sanctified by your holy blood, and our souls purified by your forgiving blood. May our union be for the forgiveness of our sins and for a new life. O Lord our God, you give me glory.
Yet and again we thank you, O Lord, for raising glory to you, for giving us your body to eat and your living blood to drink. O lover of all people, have mercy on us.
Have mercy on us, O Lord,
O
compassionate and merciful one. O lover of all people, have mercy on us.
The blessing of the Most Holy Trinity accompany you